Good evening. A very warm welcome to our evening service here at Ebenezer this evening. Just a few notices for today and for the week ahead. Our service this evening, as ever, is followed by tea and coffee. So do stay for a drink with us if you're able to afterwards. And then for the week ahead, a number of different meetings going on. On Tuesday morning, we have our coffee morning as usual at 10 o'clock. Coffee morning open to everybody. If you know people who would be interested or would enjoy that, then invite them along. That's every Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock. And then on Tuesday at 7:30 in the evening, we meet for prayer. A very important meeting in the life of the church to be able to pray together. And this week we're meeting downstairs. All the evening prayer meetings through October will be downstairs. So that's 7:30 on Tuesday evening. On Thursday morning, the toddler group meets at 9:15. And then on Friday morning, we have an extra prayer meeting this week. Another opportunity for anybody to come and join us for prayer. Friday morning at 11 o'clock in the morning. And just to confuse things, that will be up here. If you come a little bit early as well, we'll make sure that there's tea and coffee. So if you come up to 30 minutes before the meeting starts, there'll be tea and coffee available as well before we pray. So that's Friday morning. And then on Friday evening, the youth groups meet at 6:30, both Explorers and Foundations meeting then. Tonight, Jonathan Isaac is preaching at Penedray Mission. So we remember Jonathan in our prayers. And I have to give one correction to the newsletter. If you've got the newsletter, you'll notice it says that David Christopher and Jeff Bounds are preaching next week. Sorry to say, they're not, I am. So you've got me again, both services next week. So that's just a slight error there. It's a hangover from September, when that second Sunday I was preaching away, and they were just accidentally left on there. Our mission that we're supporting through the month of October is Blytheswood. We'll hear more about them in one of our evening services during the month. So those are all the notices. I'm going to begin by reading Psalm 1. Psalm 1, which links then into our reading in the book of Romans later on. But this is how Psalm 1 goes. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the way of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Let's pray. Our Lord and our God, we thank you that we can come before you this evening. We thank you that we can come together in worship. We can come together to praise your name. We ask that you would help us to do that. Lord, that you would give us that desire to worship you, that desire to praise you, that desire to know you more. Lord God, we ask for your blessing on our time together this evening. We ask for your blessing on our brother Jonathan preaching your word in Penedray. We ask for your blessing on your people gathering in different congregations across this land. Meet with your people tonight, we pray, Lord. Meet with us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We sing our first hymn together as we come and praise our God in song number 34. Stand up and bless the Lord, ye people of his choice. Stand up and bless the Lord your God with heart and soul and voice. Number 34. We turn to our reading from the book of Romans this evening, continuing our way through Paul's letter to the Romans. We're reading tonight from Romans chapter 5. If you have one of the blue church Bibles, it's on page 942. Reading Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through to 21. Romans 5, 12 to 21. This is what the Apostle Paul says. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so sin spread to all men because all sinned. For sin indeed was in the world before the law was given. But sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more of the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. And the free gift is not like the result of that one man's sin. For the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brought justification. For if, because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. For as by the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. Now the law came in to increase the trespass, but where sin increased, grace abounded all the more, so that, as sin reigned in death, grace also might reign through righteousness, leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. I pray the Lord would bless his word to us this night. We turn to our hymn books again. Our next hymn, number 305. Number 305, Christ triumphant, ever reigning, Saviour, Master, King, Lord of heaven, our lives sustaining. Hear us as we sing, yours the glory and the crown, the high renown, the eternal name. We stand and sing praise to our Lord Jesus. Number 305.
Save us as we sing.
Let's turn together before God in prayer. Let's pray together. Our Lord and our God, as we come before you this evening, we thank you, Lord, for your power and your might. We thank you for your majesty and your glory. We thank you, our God, that you are all-seeing and all-knowing. Our Lord, as we've been reading from that passage in Romans, that passage that tells us how death and sin reign. Lord, just watching our televisions, reading our newspapers, listening to our radios this last week will have reminded us of that fact. Seeing a young girl whose life was snuffed out on her way to school, stabbed to death by somebody she knew. Another young girl whose life was snuffed out on her way to school, caught up in a terrible accident on a motorway, travelling in a school bus. And these just two examples from different ends of our country of how life can be snuffed out in an instant. Through sin, or through the general effects of the fall, of how sin came into our world and spread through our world. Lord, in so many ways, hearing of stabbings on the streets of our big cities no longer shocks us. We are used to hearing those stories. Every story filled with pain, every story filled with sadness, every story tells of a family bereaved, distressed, grieving, all because of sin. Lord, we long for an end to sin. We long for an end to sadness. We long for an end to suffering. And as we have those longings deep in our hearts, what we're really saying is, come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus, return to this world. But we know that as we pray that, we pray that we cut down the amount of time, the amount of chances we have to share the gospel with those who are currently in darkness. And so while on the one hand we pray, Lord Jesus, come. We pray, Lord Jesus, bring this sinful world to an end. We also pray, Lord, give us boldness to proclaim your truth and your gospel. Lord, we pray for opportunities to share your truth. We do thank you for the opportunities that we have here in this building. We think of the coffee morning on a Tuesday morning, the toddler group on a Thursday morning, the youth groups on a Friday night. Lord, those opportunities to share the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ, to share of the good news of eternal life through our Lord Jesus. Lord, we pray. We pray that you would open hearts to receive that news. Open hearts as you open the heart of Lydia of old, who we read of in the book of Acts. Open eyes as you open the eyes of blind men. Lord God, we ask that you would speak in these different situations, that you would speak through us. Lord, we pray that you would give us the boldness to share the reason for the hope that we have, the hope that we have in Jesus, the hope of eternal life that we have. Lord, we do pray for those who are grieving. We pray for those who have been affected by those tragedies through this week. We pray that even in their sufferings, these families would find joy in the Lord Jesus. We continue to pray, Lord, for the various ongoing conflicts in our world. We continue to pray for about all that's going on in Ukraine. Lord, so often the war which is still going on just drifts from our focus, drifts from our attention. And yet, Lord, we know that day after day, week after week, there are bullets being fired, missiles being fired. Lord, we pray for peace. We long for peace. We pray that you would bring an end to that conflict. We pray too about what's continuing to go on in Azerbaijan. Lord, as we see different ethnic groups at war. But we know, Lord, that those are replicated across the world. Different nations in strife, different leaders and would-be leaders at odds. Lord, we pray for peace. We pray for an increasing spread of the good news of the gospel. That as the gospel reaches hearts of men and women, that those hearts are changed. And that those men and women turn from the course of life that they are on and seek after you. Lord, we pray for Bosco and Heidi serving you in Uganda. Lord, we thank you that we've had Jeff and Shirley with us over these last few days, and we pray for them, and we pray for Bosco and Heidi as they serve you there in Uganda. We pray for Bosco as he's still suffering with these various health complaints. We thank you that after a period of rest, he is feeling better, but not right. And so we do pray for him. We pray for healing. We pray for restoration. Lord, his desire is to be preaching the gospel. His desire is to be sharing your word with those who need to hear it. And yet he's been laid aside. Lord God, restore him. Restore him to ministry, we pray. Grant him health, grant him strength, and speak through him, we pray. Help him in his studies. Help him as he continues studying for his degree in theology. Give him wisdom as he finds a balance between studying and home life and church. Grant him and Heidi the wisdom and the strength that they need, we pray. Provide for them and sustain them, we pray. And Lord, for those close to us who are suffering as well, we pray. We pray for those who are in pain, that you would bring that pain to an end. For those who are feeling hopeless, we pray that you would bring hope. For those who need to feel your touch, to hear your voice, Lord, we pray that you would speak, that you would lay your hand upon them. And Lord, we pray that you would use us. Use us as your hands and your feet and your mouthpieces, as it were, to show your care, to show your love, to show your compassion, to show your kindness, to speak your words. Lord, use us. Use us in your service. Use us to your honor and glory, we pray. And Lord God, we ask that you would speak to us tonight. Speak to us through your word. Bless your word to us. And again, we pray for Jonathan preaching your word there in Penidray tonight. Bless him, bless that fellowship, bless that congregation, we pray. Build them in their faith, build us in our faith, we pray. Draw us closer to yourself. We ask all of these things now In the name of our Lord and our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, before we come to look at that passage again from Romans 5, we're going to sing our next hymn, number 714. Number 714. O Lord my God, I stand and gaze in wonder on the vast heavens thy wisdom hath ordained. Number 714.
Mercy from on high.
Sorry, just playing with the technology, trying to make it work. So often in sport, any great sporting story, it comes down to a clash, a collision between two people. Whether it's in the Wimbledon tennis finals or the world boxing heavyweight fights, they come down to a clash between two people. But often, even when it's team sports, it's portrayed by the media, at least, as a clash between two names. Whether it's Mikel Arteta and Pep Guardiola, if you're a football fan, or Dan Bigger and Owen Farrell, if you want to go for the rugby. It comes down to how the two individuals react and interact, how their strategies go when they're matched up against one another. Whether manager, coach, captain, or individual. And it's often the same in politics, isn't it? Our general elections will be distilled down to a clash between Rishi Sunak and... my mind's gone. Who's the Labour leader? Keir Starmer, thank you. The war in Ukraine is a clash between Vladimir Putin and Mr. Zelensky. Behind them, below them, there's an awful lot of other people involved, but when it comes to how the media portray it, it's just between those two. Just between two people. And in some ways, that's what we see here in this passage. It's a clash, as it were, between two men, two natures, two kingdoms. And we'll see that as we go through this passage under three headings. Death through one man, life through a greater man, and then in between, a gift from God. As we'll see, those two men. In some ways, we saw those two men when we opened up our service looking at Psalm 1. Psalm 1 that speaks of the wicked and the righteous. But this passage, Romans chapter 5, verses 12 to 21, speaks to us of two men. It speaks to us of two men. The first man, Adam. He's the first one that we read of here in the passage. He's the first man, of course, that we read of in the beginning of the Bible, in those early pages of Genesis. The first man. And the first part of this chapter that we were looking at a couple of weeks ago, here in chapter 5, we were looking at the first part of it. We looked at it under the theme of rejoicing. Rejoicing in hope, rejoicing in suffering, rejoicing in Christ. And then here, continuing his argument, if you were here then, you remember that I'd said that I had started off trying to look at the whole chapter in one go, and looking at it under the different headings of therefore that Paul gives us. We start again here in verse 12 with another therefore. But what we see here with Paul is what he's doing is recapping. He's recapping and going back to the beginning. It's almost as though he's asking the question again, how is it that we can rejoice? Though those first verses 1 to 11 of this chapter talk about rejoicing. But it's almost as though Paul here is stopping again, saying, well, let's think again. How is it that we can rejoice? What makes it so that we can rejoice? What are the reasons for that? And so he takes us back to the beginning. He sets the scene again to explain how it is that anyone can rejoice, what it is that there is to rejoice about. And so Paul here really takes us back to Genesis chapter 3. He takes us back to Genesis chapter 3, reminds us of the perfect world that God created, and reminds us of how that perfect world was spoiled. A perfect world, a world of beauty, a world of goodness, a world that God looked at and declared, it is very good. But a world that didn't stay that way for long. It was the perfect world where Adam and Eve were placed. They were given everything that they could possibly need. Placed there in the Garden of Eden, given almost free rein to live however they wanted. Now remember, God gave them very few rules. Some of the ones he gave them were positive. This is Genesis chapter 1, verses 28 and 29. And God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living creature that moves on the earth. And God said, behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. So there was positive instruction. Be fruitful, multiply, eat from the trees and the plants. Have dominion over the animals. But Genesis chapter 2, verse 16 and 17, the Lord God commanded the man, saying, you may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. And so these were the directions given to Adam and Eve. These were the restrictions, if you like, the rules, the limits placed on them. Do anything. Eat any from any tree except this one. Except this one. But they couldn't keep that rule. They couldn't keep that law. They couldn't follow God's rules. They were led astray. They listened to Satan's voice rather than God's. They listened to Satan's words rather than God's. They put themselves and pleasing themselves above pleasing God. And so sin came into the world. Through the one man, sin came into the world. And see how Paul explained what happened next. Back to Romans 5, verse 12. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men, because all sinned. And so this is the problem of the world. This is the problem that we all face. Everyone faces that problem of sin, that problem of rebellion against God, of disobedience against God, of doing what we want, not what God wants. That's the problem. That is the problem facing our world today. It's not war. It's not climate change. It's not the cost of living, although all of those at source have this problem. Because sin is the problem which causes all other problems. This is the problem. God's plan was that people would live with him forever. That was what his plan was. That's why he gave Adam and Eve access to the tree of life there in the Garden of Eden. That was what Adam and Eve could have and arguably should have had. Life together with God forever. Fellowship together with God forever. A perfect relationship with each other forever. But they blew it. They messed up. They couldn't keep God's rules. But it wasn't only Adam and Eve, it was all of us. It wasn't only Adam and Eve, it was all of us. That's clear throughout the passage. Adam was the original representative of the human race. And so the decision that he made on that day goes for all of us forever. He made that decision for us. Now, we might try and argue with that and say, but that's not fair. If I'd been there, I wouldn't have done that. I wouldn't have done that if I was in his place. And do you know what? I didn't ask him to make that decision on my behalf. So it's not fair. But the truth is, we would. We would all have done the same thing. Every one of us presented with that opportunity to be like God, we'd have done exactly the same thing. And we do. Every day, we all put ourselves ahead of God. We all, every day, make decisions that are not what we should. We say things, we do things, we think things that we shouldn't, that betray our hearts, our natures, our wills, as being generally of this world and not of God. Every one of us would have made that same decision. But regardless, Adam made that decision and he made that for us. And that affects every one of us. We have been seeing as we've been going through the book of Romans the impact and the effect of the law of God given through Moses to the people. And there's an interesting line in here, isn't there, where we're told that sin was before the law. Sin was in the world before the law was given. And so even before God laid out on tablets of stone for Moses and the people what they should and shouldn't do, there was still sin in the world. People still knew when they went against God. Sin is wrong. And people knew that. Even before God gave them the law to tell them what was wrong. And so death ruled, we're told, from Adam to Moses, even before the law was written down, even before the law was tabulated, if you like, sin was there in the world. Death ruled from Adam to Moses, from Genesis to Exodus. Even before God gave the law, the world was full of sin and wrong. We've seen that in those early chapters of Genesis that we've looked at. Cain and Abel, the flood, how the every desire of man was evil. The world was full of sin and wrong. And by nature, our hearts are the same. By nature, our hearts are the same. Because by nature, we are in Adam. We are in that first man. By nature. Every one of us. By nature, our desire is to please ourselves. By nature, our desire is to put ourselves first. To do what we want, the way that we want, when we want. That's our desire. Deep down, that's our desire. That's our nature. And so in our nature, we are all condemned. Again, we've seen this as we've gone through the book of Romans. By nature, we are all condemned. We are all sinners, condemned by God. Because we would, by nature, reject God. We'd reject his words. We'd reject his ways. That's how it is to be in Adam, to be in that first man. And as Paul tells us, those ways, those choices lead to death. Those ways lead us to death, to eternal death, to eternal separation from God, to eternal fire, to eternal punishment, to eternal suffering. And that's why it's vital that we must all listen to the words of God and why we must share the words of God in this world. The words that we're given through Paul's writings here. Adam's sin brought death to all. But, and that's such an important word, isn't it? But, last week we were thinking about the importance of the word yet. We're here tonight, it's but. But the free gift is not like the trespass. Because there is a way out. There is a way out of this first nature. And it's a free gift. A free gift. The trespass, the breaking of God's law brought death. But we turn now to look, if you like, at the antidote to that first nature. And what we have is a free gift. It's great to receive gifts, isn't it? Isn't it great to receive a gift? Whether it's a Christmas or for a birthday or for no real reason at all. We all like to receive a gift. And what this passage tells us about is a free gift. And it's not a gift from a friend or a relative. This is a gift from God. And Paul emphasizes here the fact that it is a free gift. It's not like one of those gifts that we see advertised. You know, sign up with us and we'll give you a free gift. Spend £100 with us and we'll give you a free gift. Answer this email, answer this survey and we'll give you a free gift. None of those are free gifts. There are always strings attached. But with God, it is a free gift. There are no strings attached. But what is it? What's it like? Well, to start with, Paul tells us what it's not like. The gift is not like the trespass. The gift is not like the result of that one man's sin. The free gift is given by grace, the grace of God. It's God giving something that is not deserved. As we've seen, Paul made it clear what is deserved is death, is punishment, is judgment. That is what is deserved by each and every one of us. But God gives instead a free gift. There is an offer of this free gift given by grace. We see elsewhere in the Bible, we see just how deserved the punishment and judgment is. This is one reference. This is Isaiah in the Old Testament. The Lord speaking in Isaiah 13, verse 9. Behold, the day of the Lord comes, cruel with wrath and fierce anger, to make the land a desolation and to destroy its sinners from it. For the stars of the heavens and their constellations will not give their light. The sun will be dark at its rising and the moon will not shed its light. I will punish the world for its evil and the wicked for their iniquity. I will put an end to the pomp of the arrogant and lay low the pompous pride of the ruthless. By nature, every one of us would come under those headings: evil, wicked, arrogant, pompous, proud. By nature, that's all of us. And so we deserve that punishment. And then Hebrews chapter 10, a New Testament letter. Hebrews 10:29, how much worse punishment do you think will be deserved by the one who has spurned the Son of God and has profaned the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and has outraged the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, vengeance is mine, I will repay, and again the Lord will judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. But the free gift of God is not like the results of sin, because the gift is undeserved. The gift is freely given. And the free gift, rather than bringing condemnation, brought justification. The free gift, rather than bringing condemnation, brought justification. That word again, it's so much a part of this letter, justification, to be justified. And in so many ways, Paul is still building here on the verses at the end of chapter 4, where he speaks of justification, where he speaks of Jesus our Lord, who was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. This is how Paul is continuing his argument, because the gift cannot be earned. The gift from God cannot be earned. Throughout the letter, Paul has been talking about how we can't be saved by our works, how we can't earn our salvation. The end of chapter 4, when Paul was speaking still about Abraham, who we thought about this morning, that was where he was writing about what it is to, he used Abraham as a case study and led to justification, to be made right with God. The words, "It was counted to him," were not written for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be counted to us who believe in him who raised from the dead, Jesus our Lord. So the free gift that was given, the free gift of grace that was given, was Jesus. The free gift given was Jesus. The grace that came through Jesus is abundant and abounding. They're great words, aren't they? Abundant and abounding. There's no shortage of grace. There's no shortage. It's abundant. It's overflowing. It keeps coming. The gift cannot be earned. The gift is freely given. Our works do not save us. We saw that in chapter 2, in chapter 3, in chapter 4. Our works cannot save us. The gift from God is not earned. The gift from God is not deserved. The gift from God is given just because God gives it. God gives it because he chooses to. Just as we should not, and all too often we do, we shouldn't decide who to give a gift to dependent on what gifts they've given to us in the past. Our gifts should be freely given one to another. God decides who the gift is to be given to and how and when. And the gift is Jesus. And trusting in Jesus, believing in Jesus, brings justification, makes us right with God. Trusting that when Jesus died, he died for you, he died for me. That's what makes the difference. That's what brings justification. That's what means that we can stand before God and say, it's just as if I'd never sinned. When God looks at us, if our trust is in Christ, it's just as if we'd never sinned before him. That's what it means. And so that's why that day of judgment, that day of cruel judgment, that day of wrath and fierce anger that Isaiah speaks of, on that day, when we stand before God, it's just as if we'd never sinned. And so we don't face God's wrath. When we stand before the judge, we're not declared guilty. We are declared justified, righteous, free from guilt. If we've accepted that free gift from God. If our trust is in Christ, then we can stand before him. Righteous, justified, glorified. That's the free gift. And so we thought of death coming through one man. We thought of the gift from God in verses 15 to 17, and we continue through our last section, verses 18 to 21, that tell us about life through a greater man. So sin came into the world through one man, Adam, and death came through Adam. And by nature, we're all destined for death. But the free gift can turn us away from that. There is that alternative, that other way, the way not of death, but the way of life. Not a way of us living forever in this world. Getting older and older, but living forever. Who would want that? People pay thousands, don't they? Millions in the striving for that. Striving to live forever in this world. That's not what we're talking about. Not a way for our bodies to go on the way that they are forever in this world. What we're talking about is far greater. What we're talking about is eternal life. Not with creaking, aging bodies. Not surrounded by those sad stories in the news that we've just been praying about and thinking about. But eternal life. Together with this greater man, the Lord Jesus Christ. It comes only through him, and it is life with him. But how does it come? Well, Paul tells us that this gift, this way of life, can come to those who believe and trust in Jesus because of the obedience of Jesus. because of the obedience of Jesus. The obedience of Jesus that counters the disobedience of Adam. Adam was given one real rule to follow, and he failed. He couldn't keep it. Jesus had the entire law of God to keep, and he kept it. Every letter, every mark, every law, every word, he kept them all. This is what the writer to the Hebrews says. This is Hebrews 5, verse 7. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him. Jesus, the Son of God. Jesus, a Son of God who had spent eternity with his Father, constrained to a human body, walking on this earth, followed God's laws perfectly, and learned obedience even as he suffered, to become the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him. It's only through Jesus that we can be saved. It's only through Jesus that we can be justified. It's only through Jesus that our human nature can be overturned, that we can be taken from the kingdom of Adam to the kingdom of Christ. And it's all because of his obedience, because he never sinned. Through 33 years of life as a human being on earth, he never sinned, not as a child, not as a teenager, not as a man. He never did one thing that was wrong, not even a thought, not a word. Even when tempted face to face by the devil, he did no wrong. Even when up to the last minute in the Garden of Gethsemane, on the night when he was betrayed, when there was could have been temptations to look for another way, what did he do? He cried out in prayer. Luke 22, he withdrew from them about a stone's throw and knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And there appeared to him an angel from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. And his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. This was very real anguish on the Lord Jesus Christ. This was very real anguish going on in his heart, in his mind, in his soul. If there is another way, nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And even there, he did no wrong. He did not sin. Even faced with, we can't understand what he faced. We can't understand. He knew that he was going to face the entire wrath of God on him. Even then, he did no wrong. He sought God's will and said, your will, not mine, be done. Even then, he did nothing that was wrong, and yet he was still punished. He did nothing wrong, and yet he was still punished. He still died the death on the cross. He still died the death of the curse, despite never having sinned. And Paul writes elsewhere, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18, all this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. He knew no sin, and yet he was made sin. Not made to sin, but made sin. And so he had to be punished. He had to be crushed. He had to die, that the wrath of God, the wrath due to each one of us and due to us, deserved by us, was instead borne by him and satisfied. The wrath of God was satisfied in Christ. This is the grace of God. This is the gift of God. This is the grace that can lead to eternal life that comes through Jesus, not life forever in this life, in this world, but life, a glorious life with restored, glorious bodies. A life where there is no sin, where there is no pain, where there is no heartache, where there is no suffering. Life together with Jesus. The disobedience of Adam leads to death. And unless you turn away from that disobedience, then death is all you will receive. Unless you turn to Christ, eternal death is the result. So what can I say? What can I say except turn to Jesus? Turn to Jesus now. If you're here tonight and have never put your trust in Jesus, do it now. If you're watching this on the live stream and have never trusted in Jesus, then do it. Do it now. Whatever you have done in your life, turn it over to Jesus. Whatever wrong, whatever bad you have done, turn it over to Jesus and do it now. No matter how bad, no matter how ugly, no matter how severe, hand it over to Jesus now, seeking his forgiveness, his cleansing, his redemption. Remember the words of John in his first letter. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. All unrighteousness. And the words of James in his letter, James 4, verse 7 onwards. Submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Draw near to God. Draw near to God. Submit yourselves to God. Remember, justification comes through Jesus. Reconciliation to God comes through Jesus. Salvation comes through Jesus. Which of these two men do you want to follow? Adam, whose choices lead to death, to punishment, to separation from God? Or Jesus, the greater man, whose choices and obedience lead to life, eternal life, everlasting life, peace and joy? Which of these men will you follow? Let's pray. Our Lord, our God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the challenge of your word, but we thank you for all the joy that your word reveals to us. And we thank you above all for the free gift of eternal life, of salvation through Jesus Christ. Lord, if there are any here tonight not knowing Christ as Saviour, I pray that you would urge them, draw them to yourself, that they too might know salvation, eternal life, forgiveness, cleansing, reconciliation, justification. Lord, work in our midst, we pray, to your honour and your glory. Amen. Well, we close our time with a final hymn. And as ever, if you want to talk to me about anything you've heard tonight, please do come and find me afterwards. I'd love to talk to you. But our closing hymn, number 178. One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as vile as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Number 178.
Thank you.
And now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Saviour, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen.